The first thing I want to look at is, I don't know how many of you watched one of the videos which I'm sure has been put on the group. One video of what's happening in Ladakh, in the conflict with China. This is a video sent by my friend Kadri, which is a very interesting video. I hope that all of you can see it. If you've not seen it, make sure that you see it at least after the session. The video is interesting for three or four reasons. One, it's because the video looks at the issue in a very dispassionate way. It talks about the two areas of conflict. And also it talks about the incident. It talks about the mistake of the Indian colonel with the few people who went without arms and possibly challenged. And then there was a skirmish and he was badly injured and he lost his life. And also looks at the whole thing that way. I compare it with what is happening on television screens, because there is so much of passions running high. And we're looking at something, because if you look at Ladakh itself, the border we share with China is quite extensive, even in the Ladakh region. And if you actually go to Ladakh and you go towards Pangong Lake, beyond that, you go to a place called Chushul. Chushul, there is a memorial to soldiers who died fighting the Chinese, and then the Chinese withdrew from there. But the most important memorial is to one Kumaon regiment led by Major Shaitan Singh, and the battle for Rezangla. Recently now, there are a lot of these videos which are circulating about the battle of Rezangla. So if there are issues, we also need to understand, if you look at the terrain of Ladakh and many other places, there are no clear boundaries or exact thing of where Indian border ends and where the Chinese border starts. Because these are all supposed to be markers. And also, if you look at the video, the very interesting way in which a retired army officer says, if you look at Pangong Lake, he says Chinese perceptions talk about the LAC as being up till here. Indian perceptions talk about this. And that is something which I want us to understand when you're talking about reality. These are all in terms of indications of what is possible, what is happening. There are no clear ground lines and say that this is exactly, no lines drawn. So for us, we need to be better informed when you're looking at things like that. Today I've sent a long article on an economist who's looking at, in terms of modification. I want to read the article because of two or three reasons. One is, I talked about on the first day where I said that all of us have to be better informed, okay, in terms of knowing reality. So, and also we must use our imagination. Here is an economist who's using an imagination to find better ways of doing economic activity. And also, for us to understand, there's so many things within economic ideology and practice which we don't know. So please read the article. But in that article, there's also one very interesting thing that when she was young, her father was a physicist, and she was watching news and would get very upset. And she would say, why are you getting upset? News is less information. And her father tells her that, no, it's not information. They are getting you to think in a certain way, or they are wanting you to think in the way they think or the way they want. But that's something to understand when you're talking about news and things like that. Also, let me look at the questions. There's one question asking for any material on the on privacy. I think one of the best books available in India is a book called Privacy 3.0. by Rahul Mutton. It's a HarperCollins publication. And that also, I'm sure Abhishek would have or will put it on the group, because that is it's a good book that looks at not just law, but also looks at technology. Also calls for us to look at technology a little more positively and not only look at the negative side and the dangers implicit. So therefore, that is a good book. There's another book which I also put called by Right to Privacy and Indian Law by Kiran Deshta. It's a little more academic. The first book which I said I would possibly recommend. There are a lot of international books on right to privacy by a lot of authors that you can look at. But this Privacy 3.0 is a very interesting, and I think it's an articulate book written by a lawyer who deals also with technology. So it is maybe you may enjoy that book more than the other book which I also mentioned. Now, in the questions, there are some questions which I want to deal first with. There's a question in terms of, is it ethical for governments to intrude into privacy? The first question, especially when you're young, maybe when you're older also, we are guided by a lot of shoulds. You know, government should be doing this, or we should be doing this. We always talk about this whole moral-ish angle. But what I want to understand is reality, especially politics, is defined by expediency. What is expediency? The art of what is possible and what is convenient. Okay. A lot of what happens is very rarely defined by shoulds. It's always defined by expediency. So once you understand that, then we don't get angry, but we need to understand if that's how governments act, what is it that we should be doing? What is it that we can do? What is it that we must do to counter or to protect ourselves? That's the first question. Second, again, the same question about in terms of is it right for Google or anyone? See, companies usually do not have a moral compass. Very few companies have a real strong moral compass. Companies are in this for business. And a lot of time they'll compromise with governments and whatever else. So therefore we need to be realistic. And therefore you need to take your own precautions. How do you protect your data? How do you understand every agreement you enter into? So if you become more literate about these issues, you possibly be better able to tackle this whole issue of privacy. So, and there's one question we talked about this whole issue of media privacy and ethics, which I will possibly deal with today, okay, in terms of understanding this. So let me now start today's topic on understanding Indian media, why journalism has failed us, the variety of things. But before that, when you use the word media, you're talking about a variety of instruments. A film is a part of media. Various other ways of communication is a part of media. I think about exactly 10 years ago, I'd gone with students to a place called Medak near Hyderabad. It's about 100 kilometers from Hyderabad, to a village called Pastapur. There's an organization called Deccan Development Society. Now, Deccan Development Society is very interesting because it mostly works with non-literate women. I like the term non-literate. I don't call them illiterate. It calls them non-literate women. And these non-literate women run their own radio station. These non-literate women also are very good at making videos, which look at agriculture practices, agriculture biodiversity. And there are a lot of things which these women do, and most of these women are from marginalized communities, Dalits and others. So therefore, it's a very interesting experiment. Last 2 years, this organization has won awards. Women from the Deccan Development Society last year won something called the Equator Award from the United Nations Development Program. Okay. And this year, the Deccan Development Society, just in June, has won an award from, I think, Prince Albert of Monaco. So please check the Deccan Development Society. When you say media is many things. Second, when you talk about media, it also includes films. Because when you talk about media, it's not just journalism, but also films, which are a very important instrument of socialization. What is socialization? Process of social learning. They pick up cues about, social behavior, communication, a lot of things. And I remember, I don't know how many of you are familiar with somebody called Dr. Arun Tikekar. Dr. Arun Tikekar used to be in terms of early editor of Lok Satta. He was also a historian. He's written two books on the history of Mumbai University. He also written a book called The De-intellectualization of Mumbai, which is an interesting book for you to look at. Now, he had come to college once, and till then, I was extremely critical of the censor board, because I said the government has no business to censor. But he said the censor board's activity is not just about saying what is right or wrong, but he said the censor board's role is also to ensure that the media respects sensibilities of a plural society. I want you to understand this, okay? To make sure that the media understands, respects the sensibilities of a plural society. And he gave an example at that time, and this is an example I have used in class, but you can use a lot of other examples. And the example he used was of a film called Tango Charlie. Now, Tango Charlie is a film on the BSF, okay? And it looks at the various encounters of the BSF in Naxal areas, dealing with terror groups. It also looks at encounter BSF during the Bodo crisis. And he said that some of the Bodos complained to the information ministry, saying that the portrayal of the Bodos as bloodthirsty savages, okay, is something which is the only lens through which India will understand us. Most of us in the rest of India don't even know who the Bodos are. The term Bodo itself is a term for about five tribes of the plains in Assam. And therefore, media is our instrument for understanding the world. And therefore, whether it's not just journalism or also film, some of you are filmmakers, will become filmmakers. How much of research do you really do to understand sensibilities? If you look at Hindi cinema, the way they treat people from the LGBT community, it's always in terms of, you know, it's just caricatures. Okay. Or if you look at all Hindi films, you know, I'm sure many of you, some of you this generation may not know, there's an old Hindi film called Padosan. You must watch the film. And there's a very famous song in that, Chatur Nar. I'm sure some of you are familiar with the song. So where Mehmood plays a role of a Tamil teacher. Again, that's a thing for many people in the north. Madras is anybody from the four southern states. So there's all, you don't know which exact place in from Tamil Nadu the person is, but there's a lot of caricaturing. So in terms of various kinds of media, what is our understanding of multiple realities of India? Even a lot of journalists sometimes do not really do enough research. I don't know how many of you are familiar with once former speaker of the Lok Sabha, Sangma. Okay. He was from Meghalaya, and he also served in many ministries. And he said once a minister of state from the Home Ministry came and said that all of you, I mean, you must be facing a lot of problems from Myanmar. So he said, why Myanmar? He said, no, you share borders with Myanmar. And he said, the minister in the government of India does not know that Meghalaya is surrounded only by Bangladesh. And therefore, a lot of times, you know, newspapers, television, doesn't really know how to cover. Okay. I'm not really much of a Tamilian because I've stayed a lot of time outside. But also always boils my mind when a lot of news leaders, when they talk about DNK, they don't know how to pronounce it. They don't say Dravida Munnetra Kazhagam. They said Kazhagam because it's K-Z-H-A. Or when they talk about Kozhikode, they always say Kozhikode because they read it literally. So when you're talking about the press, before we talk about all the other issues, is that a lot of times there is very poor quality understanding of the complex reality of India. Okay, so that is the first thing which we must address. Second, in terms of, is press really responsible? In 1978, the government of India, through an act, set up the Press Council of India. The Press Council of India is quasi-judicial in nature. It's usually headed by a retired judge of the Supreme Court. It is about 28 members. 20 of them are people nominated by various news agencies, I mean, newspapers and other agencies. Now, the Press Council of India is supposed to do a variety of things, ensure the freedom of the press is protected, to ensure that there is, you know, that the quality of, monitor the quality of journalism. But it is completely toothless. Okay. And I remember many years ago, this is nearly about 15, 20 years ago, in Times of India, there was one particular weekly columnist who was also a socialist, a socialite. And she had written about one NDTV news anchor. And her article was quite disrespectful. There was body shaming, sexist. And a lot of people complained, and even there were complaints lodged with the Press Council of India. And the Press Council of India sent a letter to Times of India. Now, Times of India is a big newspaper. Times of India refused to even respond to them. So we don't have really sufficient independent regulatory mechanisms. So that is one part to understand when talking about the press. The nature of the press in India, we don't have regulatory mechanisms. The next part is, if you look at freedom of the press, before I look at other issues, freedom of the press, we don't have a separate article or separate constitutional provision which defines or protects the freedom of the press. Unlike the US Constitution, in the US Constitution, in the First Amendment, this is a separate provision which talks about the freedom of the press. It defines the freedom of the press. The press has the freedom to question a lot of things, say a lot of things. Therefore, that kind of clear definition the Constitution of India does not have. It comes under the freedom of expression, Article 19, 2. Okay. But it has a lot of riders. That, what are the riders in terms of public order, national security, friendly relation between countries? If you look at the First Amendment, which is the freedom of speech, okay? Because at that time there was fear, because there were some groups which were actually writing and suggesting war with Pakistan and things like that. And therefore, this whole friendly relations with other countries, then in terms of, you know, obscenity, morality, also, so there are a lot of these things which are, and even contempt of court. Now, see, contempt of court is two ways of looking at it. One dimension of contempt of court is when a government body does not respect the order of the court, it's contempt of court. The other meaning of contempt of court is that this is something which just comes from the British era. If anybody is critical of the court judgment, okay, court pronouncements, that person can also be punished with contempt of court. A famous example was Arundhati Roy. She was very critical of the Supreme Court judgment on the Narmada Bachava Andolan petition. And they said if she apologizes, she will go to jail for one day, otherwise she'll have to go for a month and pay punishment or whatever else. Now, that kind of a thing is something which I think is unfortunate. Why can't all of us be critical of judicial pronouncements? It's a human institution. It's an institution which is defined by the Constitution. Okay. So all of this is, and therefore when you talk about this whole idea of public order, again, we cannot criticize a lot of people. As I said yesterday, those of you who were there last evening, I talked about this whole issue of what I call Official Secrets Act. There's so many things you can't write about. There's so many things, whether it's about defense or other things, which may not be really secret, but something which is necessary for transparency. So those are concerns in terms of the kind of restrictions that exist. Okay. Also in terms of you cannot incite people to violence or, you know, defamation. This defamation thing is again a huge issue, because any comment can be taken as defamation. Now, currently there's this whole issue of sedition. What the courts unfortunately have not been very clear about defining sedition, and it should be defined. Because unless it's an attempt to overthrow the system, criticizing the system cannot be sedition. challenging the system of social justice cannot be sedition. So a lot of times, various newspapers, agencies for defamation, see, also sometimes politicians, I remember when, what's his name? I forget his name. This guy was the editor of Illustrated Weekly, which was a magazine. Now he makes films. So he wrote an article about corruption, and the chief minister of Orissa charged a 1 crore defamation suit. And then after about 2 years, he apologized. He said, "As do I run a magazine or should I go to court?" So a lot of times, the fact that there are so many restrictions often really restricts the press. So therefore, that's a problem in the way we don't have sufficient safeguards for objective journalism, all of this, because there are so many such restrictions. And many of the, so this whole national security again is so nebulous. Public order is nebulous. Nebulous is, it's not defined. So when you don't define something, it can be interpreted the way it suits somebody. Okay. So therefore, and also increasingly we are becoming an extremely intolerant society, whether it's politicians or individuals. After the lecture, please Google and see if you can find a book called Don't Spare Me Shankar. Don't Spare Me Shankar is a collection of cartoons by a very popular, well-known cartoonist of the 1950s and 60s. And this particular comment was by Nehru. And he told this thing that he said that, you know, even though I'm the Prime Minister, please make sure that you are at your critical best when it comes to me or anybody else. That kind of thing, see, Nehru may, as a human being, has a lot of flaws, policy flaws, all of, but this tolerance, this willing to take criticism, and maybe at that time there's no social media. You should look at some of the debates in the parliament when Ramano Lohia was there. Ramano Lohia was had a visceral hatred of the Congress and Nehru, and sometimes you should see some of the comments he has made. Almost abusive, but right. Nehru didn't really take offense because that's a part of freedom of expression. So when you're talking about media, the media is increasingly operating in a climate of intolerance. Why am I emphasizing this when I'm talking about, before I'm talking about newspapers, is today a very important part of dissemination of ideas and information is social media. And one of the first things the social media does not respect is pluralism. What is pluralism? Multiplicity of ideas. Okay. If I make a comment which is critical of a personal government, look at the kind of trolling which can happen. Okay. Whether it is of the government, there are so many people who are critical of abusive of the Prime Minister, so many people are abusive of everybody else. But any kind of trolling is against the spirit of pluralism. And you can't really have quality journalism, especially now we talk about citizen journalism. Okay. Now, this cannot happen unless we all learn to respect pluralism. And pluralism is what? That in terms of that we stop taking offense so easily. There's a very interesting anecdote associated with a minister called Natwar Singh. This minister, Natwar Singh, was a bureaucrat, IFS officer, who was inducted by Indira Gandhi into her cabinet. So before he was going to take his office, he went and asked her, should I get a new wardrobe? Okay. Because as an IFS officer, you wear suits and tie and all of that. She said, get a thicker skin. What is getting a thicker skin? Develop. Okay, don't get offended by everything which people say, because people will say, especially for the government, opposition, newspaper, all of that. You will need to be clear of what is it that you want to do. But this idea of extreme intolerance, okay, and that is something which is seeped into our body politic. And therefore, even if you look at our newspaper, our television debates, there is so much of, you know, this shaming of people who may have opinion. I mean, anybody can be easily called an anti-national. All of this, why? Because you're having opinions which are what one would call divergent from ours. And a plural country like ours, there will be this divergence. How many of you are familiar with this person called Nambudripad? Nambudripad was the first Marxist chief minister of Kerala. Okay? And if you can find, if you can Google and find his article which he wrote in 1962, okay, about the Chinese invasion. We all talk about India-China war, again, people are talking about it. And if you read his article in his editorial, he blames India for Chinese attack on India. He's an Indian politician and he's writing in English as well. And he says, that it was India which breached Panchasila. The Panchasila is what? It included things like non-interference. By giving asylum to Tibetans, including Dalai Lama, political asylum. A lot of Tibetans use Indian territory to target Chinese positions and people within Tibet. Okay. So he said that it is interference. And therefore, but the body politic at that time was comfortable with that. Okay. It was something which blamed the government. The government didn't take offense, but it was an opinion. Today, can we have that kind of a thing? We can't have that, because anything you say, and I remember I think in 2003 or 4, there was this major, or before that, there was this major coffin scam. Okay, where in this, and George Fernandez, the defense minister, said, if you're going to criticize the army, you're anti-national. Now, if you're talking about lack of probity, you know, integrity, and you get blamed for this. So these are things which I want all of us to understand. So for us, if you want really a free press, a bold press, respect for pluralism must come in. And all of us must examine our own limits of tolerance. I don't know how many of you are familiar with a book called Worshipping False Gods. Worshipping False Gods is a book by Arun Shori. It's a book which is pure vitriol, pure very strong cervical criticism of Ambedkar. And I remember when the book came, a lot of Dalit scholars said, we will not burn the book, we will not do a lot of these things. He said, we will respond intellectually, because there's an intellectual argument thing about attacking the legacy of Ambedkar. We should respond intellectually. And that's something which I want all of us to understand. And I hope that this group here, we are about 70 of us or 65, whatever number of us here. This new culture of of more tolerance in social media, because our whole problem of citizen journalism this is in terms of filled with this kind of intolerance, which I think is because it's abusive, it's humiliate, it does a lot of things to break the spirit. So therefore, that's something which is important for us to understand in the context of journalism. Okay, so this is the what I call my grounding thoughts. Now, when you come to journalism, the first question is, how much of journalism in India is clearly committed to objective delivery of news? A lot of newspapers have become more instruments of PR. Okay. How many of you are familiar with something called MediaNet? Okay. Please Google after this session. Also, please look at something called the Tattva Pact. Tattva Pact is an agreement between Ad Factors, the largest PR agency in India, and Times of India. Okay. Also, if you look at magazines like Frontline, their features under something called Focus. Now, Focus is something, again, those articles are all PR. A lot of people may read it as a part of features. So what happens to MediaNet is that, especially in the supplements, okay, most of it is information which is promoting ideas and company ideas, masquerading as truth. Therefore, this whole transformation of media into a purely commercial enterprise. Sameer Jain, who was at one time the managing director of Bennett and Coleman, famously said that newspapers are like soap. It's just a product. So why do you need a chief editor? He says, even if I don't have editors, I can still run the newspaper. So that's the kind of thing in terms of complete disrespect for journalism. Also in terms of, as journalists, what is priority? Somebody like Girilal Jain once said, I'm an Indian first and a journalist next. Girilal Jain again was a very respected editor. A similar statement was made by an American journalist, Dan Rather, after September 11 attack happened. But later on, Dan Rather regretted that statement. He said, the commitment of a journalist should be the truth. Okay. And that's something which is very important, because so-called national interest is often the interests of the people in power, okay? The politicians in power, or groups in power, or whatever else in power. So therefore, in terms of, so slowly, this whole identifying of national interests with politics of a certain kind is undermining journalism. Also, we talk about journalism again. There's a very interesting, I think, book by Inder Malhotra about what happened to most of the journalists on the emergency. And I think the title of the book is, They Crawled When She Asked Them to Bend. Okay. This is also, I think, a statement made by Advani about a lot of journalists who just succumbed to the pressure of V.C. Shukla, who was the information minister, and Sanjay Gandhi, and therefore they were not doing objective news. Okay. Now, that is again in terms of this political pressure on to ensure that news does not really expose, because one of the important tasks of journalism is to be watchdog, to ensure that the certain basic values are upheld by the government, because all governments will misuse power. And also, if you look at the term, the fourth estate, it comes from the context of the French Revolution. Because at the time of the French Revolution, in the so-called advisory forum, there was the peasants represent an estate, the church represent an estate, and the aristocracy represent another estate. And therefore, these would help shape policy. And the press, as something which represented people, was called the fourth estate. So in terms of when you say the press is the fourth estate, to what extent is the press sticking to this kind of role? This is something which you need to do. The next thing is, when you talk about media, again, any conversation in media must understand the plurality of media in India. When you use the term mainstream media, what is mainstream media? Who constitutes the mainstream? There's, in India, you can't have a mainstream. If I go to Shillong, which newspapers are mainstream there? It'll be the newspapers which are published there. A lot of Indian newspapers possibly don't even have an edition there. And that's why, again, if you go to Kashmir, okay, so newspapers in the Kashmir Valley and others are mainstream for them. That's a source of information. That's a source of making sense of their reality. Similarly, if you go to Telangana and Andhra, you have the Deccan Chronicle, which at one time was an attempt to understand, which represented the ethos and the culture, the sensibilities of people there. The Hindu was basically Tamil Nadu. The Telegraph and the Statesman represented the journalistic ethos in West Bengal, along with Anand Bazar Patrika. And also, for a lot of us who are English speaking, I'm sure we never read a single edition of a newspaper of like Dainik Jagran, which is the largest selling newspaper in India, or Dainik Bhaskar. There are so many Rajasthan Patrika, there's so many Amar Ujala, there's so many of them which are local. So, therefore, when you talk about, or if you go to Jharkhand, okay, Prabhat Khabar was it's a fairly young newspaper, 1984, which came in to really cover news, to focus on news of that region. So it has representation in Jharkhand, Bihar, and parts of West Bengal. But that was something which was, again, try and focus on issues which are a problem there. They're one of the first who did the major work on the fodder scam, because that was an issue which was important for them people, because it was a diversion of public money in Bihar. And therefore, when you're talking about this whole issue of how do you understand media in India, it is plural. How do you understand that? And also, what are the different voices? Okay. I'm sure those of you who have done BMM are familiar with this whole experiment called Khabar Lahariya in parts of UP and Madhya Pradesh. Okay. They're in digital format. They reach over 5 million people. It's basically digital and other forms of media which is purely run by women. And women from marginalized communities. And their focus is that they will only focus on rural news. Okay. Violence against women a lot, but primarily rural news, including violence against women. And they have journalists and stringers. And, you know, it's a very interesting experiment. So therefore, there are a lot of interesting media experiments which are happening. So we need to understand that as well. So we need to also understand in terms of, when we say journalism and whatever else, so what are we criticizing? So we need to be specific. We are criticizing, or we are critical of, or we are concerned about certain kind of journalism. The other part of journalism is in terms of the kind of ownership. If you go to Kerala, okay, there are television stations, newspapers which are owned by either the Marxist Party or the Congress, or the church in Kerala has a lot of influence in journalism. It can actually block news in certain papers, certain areas, because it also has influence in a lot of areas. So therefore, that's one. If you look at Sun TV, especially in Tamil Nadu, okay, it's connected with a family which is very close to the founder of the Dravida Munnetra Kala, the top leadership of the Dravida Munnetra Kala. Similarly, if you look at Andhra, Sakshi, again, it's connected to the current chief minister. So you have, in Maharashtra also, there are newspapers connected to political parties, political families. So all of that is something which, again, raises the question of how really objective is the news, or what is it that you're consuming. So that's something which we must look at. So therefore, when you're talking about the whole issue of understanding on terms of where is it that we're failing. The other thing is in terms of one of the issues that I'm supposed to talk on is the issue of what we call fake news. So when you say fake news, what is it? Basically, in terms of propaganda, which is being circulated as news. Second, news which is not based on rigorous checking of facts. That is something which also means that as consumers of news, which also we have to be critical. I'm sure some of you here are familiar with the work of Walter Lippmann in the 1920s, when he did work on public opinion. What did he say public opinion? He said public opinion is created by images in the head. What are these images in the head? Images in the head, he says, these images are put by newspapers. And therefore, when you're talking about newspapers in terms of what we understand, what we call this whole idea of agenda setting. What is agenda setting? Newspapers may not tell us what to think, but they can tell us what to think about in terms of the importance they give to the kind of news which we consume. Okay. That's why P. Sainath had a lot of problem with most newspapers and television channels. That they never adequately covered farmer suicides, because farmer suicides were taking place about 13 states at one time. Okay. And the numbers were more than 2 lakh. And isn't that an important concern? So why wasn't anybody discussing issues? also in terms of the other areas of public concern which we should be discussing is something which is hardly covered or never covered, which is something which all of us must be looking at. So therefore, when you're talking about this whole issue of newspapers, problem is in terms of what is the space for various kinds of journalism. I'm not sure whether you are familiar with something called development journalism or public journalism. So development journalism is basically which focuses on human rights, social justice. Okay. Public journalism look at public interest. So are there people who will represent this kind of journalism? And the last part before I start winding up is in terms of, I don't know how many of you are familiar with the origins of Al Jazeera. Al Jazeera is this news channel which is based in Qatar. Why did it start? Because in the Gulf War in 1991, there's something called the CNN effect. Because all feeds had to come from CNN because they're the only ones present in the setting of war. And therefore, they said, we must have an independent voice. So what are the ways in which independent voices can be created, sustained, maybe financially? As I said in my first session onwards, I said, one of the most important things is, how much are we using our imagination to find solutions? Okay. I understand that there's a lot of problem with newspapers and television channels. Okay. What are the solutions? Where do we start with? What do you start with? Or what is it that we must be addressing? Okay, that's something which I want us to look at. So this is broadly what I thought I will cover. But let me reiterate what I said. First, if you really want to have better quality journalism, respect for pluralism. Okay, understand that journalism must is there as something which highlights what is going wrong, which is objective. And I don't know how many of you are familiar with the policy of the Telegraph. The Telegraph at one time had a policy. They said they will ensure that both sides of the opinion are allowed to be expressed in the newspaper. Then people can decide for themselves. And I was also very, very impressed with the Telegraph when I've gone with students many years ago. They're the only newspaper at that time. I don't know what's the policy now. They're an editor for the editorial page. Okay. And for a long time, there was a person called Dr. Rudrangshu Mukherjee, who was a historian, an academic who was a editor of the editorial page. So therefore, he would really ensure that in terms of good quality stuff. Because now, if you look at the editorial page, there's a lot of articles which are often ghostwritten for politicians. Okay? You see articles in the name of that, that's one. Second, there are so many pieces which don't have any credit. So who's citing them? Okay. So all of that is, there's a lot of problem in the way I'm looking at print. And television is something which there's a lot which needs to be done. I've talked about social media, citizen journalism in terms of how do you ensure that there is sufficient research, cross-checking of sources, all of that. But my biggest thing is, can we create a revolution which gets back pluralism, respect for multiple points of view? And can we increase our tolerance threshold? We get so easily upset about things which are said about, okay, all of us. And that is seeping into every institution. Okay. It's not just about any particular political party. In West Bengal, if you have cartoons which make fun of Mamata Banerjee, you could be arrested, beaten up. Okay. It can happen in every state, depending on how significant the party organization is. So pluralism is something which I think is most important for us to focus on. Yeah? I'll stop here because I think we must have time for questions.
Yeah, so if you all have questions, please put I have a question or type out your question. We'll read it for you. The first one today is from Meghna. How difficult is it for a journalist or media house to stand their ground or keep being watchdogs irrespective of political or people pressure? Are there any ways to help?
Okay. The first thing is, if any of you who are journalists are just starting out, you're a BMM student, there's a very good book called Letters to a Young Journalist. It's a small book. You must get that book because it's very interesting advice for that. Second, when you say, there are still newspapers within restrictions which still have articles which are critical, still have articles which have contrary positions. A large number of the newspapers are pro-establishment or they don't really challenge the establishment. But as I said, there are voices. And newspapers, you can find out whether in each part of the country there are newspaper voices. There are journalists. Okay, of course, many of them in the last 2-3 years have lost their jobs. A lot of magazines, newspapers have terminated, and even newer television channels have terminated people who are seen as being very critical of the government or critical of the establishment. So it's a tough challenge. Therefore, we'll have to figure out, are there any alternative models of journalism which can be group funded? There are a lot of these things which we can explore. Okay. So that's, I don't know how many of you are familiar with a journalist called Niranjan Takle. He's written a very interesting article on Savarkar. He also was a person who's done a lot of work on this Justice Lohia case, Lohia's death case, where he believes, and he says, and I listened in a meeting, he said, what has been published is just 20% of what I have really unearthed. It's 80% is still there, which has not been unearthed. So there are journalists, maybe we'll have to figure out what is it that we can do. As I said, imagination is needed to create new structures, new systems. Okay. All of you are extremely bright. Please think. Yeah. I'm not sure that I fully answered, but I'll come back to this question a little later. Yeah, let me look at other questions.
Yeah, next one is from Parikshit. He says, while I'm currently dealing and working with media houses and studying masters in filmmaking, I would like to know from you, sir, how do you improve the image of media and role of mass media in the current times where majority of companies and political parties are holding the major shares of private and public domain of media houses? Also, just to be in the top trend or satisfy a party's emotions, is it always necessary to add in that extra little bit of fluff to a news or a story?
See, if you look at the traditional principle of journalism, any kind of sensationalism, any kind of what is called vacuous without substance, is really against the traditions of journalism. It is true that there's a lot of compromise within the journalism field, but I don't want to generalize. There are still independent spaces and things like that. How do you improve the image? The first thing is, are we really engaging with people? What do I mean by engaging with people? How many of us are having conversations about issues with general people? When I say the reach of social media is so much, can we use it to have better conversations? And in terms of figure out where do you find independent space. So when you say image has to come from 2 or 3 ways. One, image will come when your content is better, when you're able to stand up to certain things and there are people who are doing it. So I'm sure some of you are familiar with those spaces. Talk to them and see if you can whether we can form a collective of such voices. And if you're looking at filmmaking, how can you make a film in terms of ensure greater introspectiveness, make people question their own assumptions, their own prejudices, without falling into the trap of being simplistic. This word simplistic is often not understood. What is simplistic? When you give a unidimensional solution to a multidimensional problem. So for that can be simplistic. So therefore you have to be careful that as a filmmaker, as whether you're a documentary filmmaker or whatever else, that you're able to ensure that you are understanding the complexity of the issue. So even when I'm discussing it, I don't want to give these pat answers. There are no pat answers. Collectively, we have to figure out solutions.
Yeah. Next one is from Abhishek. Daniel Schmettenberger, a public intellectual who thinks a lot about long-term civilization development and the role of sense-making devices like media in achieving it, talks about misinformation as equivalent to pollution in the information ecology. Just as large industries externalize the cost of development on the environment in form of pollution and degradation, large corporations teamed up with governments inflict misinformation on a society to secure their profit margins and power. In this light, what are your views on the increasing asymmetry of power between individuals and the big data, plus AI wielding powers? How has this power asymmetry shifted in your lifetime?
Okay, the first question is in terms of when you talk about asymmetry of power, that has already possibly always existed. A few people in terms of, you know, again, even if you look at the newspaper of like Hindu, which is supposed to be fairly objective and stands up for issues, it has never really done any major features which looking at the huge problem in horse racing. Horse racing is this domain where there's huge amounts of corruption. Why? Because the family which runs the Hindu group, Ramaswamy, they also very big in races. Okay. So that kind of nexus existed. Or if you look at a magazine like Outlook, okay, at one time it was very influential. Outlook, a lot of funding has come from the Rahejas. Okay. So therefore, in terms of real estate stories, scams, all of that, the Outlook never did too many stories. So that kind of business control, that is something which people like Noam Chomsky have talked about, and I'm sure there's a lot of work which is done. Only now it is possibly increased where the more visible media like the broadcast media is greatly under control. And as I said, there will always be space. Of course, in my lifetime, this control is drastically increased. That I definitely agree. But I'm saying whether it's artificial intelligence or in terms of that, there is still a lot of hope and space for what we call democratic spaces. We are not exercising this. There can be lots of collectors. So as I gave the example of this Khabar Lahariya, please look at the example of Khabar Lahariya. Who are these women? Poor women, marginalized communities. And they've been waging a struggle to understand reality from their perspective. If they can do it, I'm sure a lot of us who have this technology can do a lot more. It is a difficult uphill battle. Okay. But there are people, this whole idea of open source itself has come because a lot of people said, why should the information, etc., be controlled by some people? So there will be this constant challenge to dominance and control. So both will happen simultaneously. Okay. So as I said, if we can figure out, let's focus on solution. I don't have ready answers, as I said. And technology and social media, a lot of everybody here on this group, I'm sure, know it better than me. I always say I'm a fossil, so I don't really understand these things much. But that's something which you guys do. So please do something. Stop looking at old people who've destroyed so much for answers. Yeah.
True.
Yeah. Next question.
Next one is from Shauna. Shauna, you can ask your question.
Yeah.
Good evening, sir. Yeah. So basically, this is in context with the current mass bloodbath that's been happening across media houses in India. Like it's also in the name of the COVID pandemic and cost cutting, saying the economy is dropping. But surprisingly, the most of the people who are being sacked are high level editors who have put in more than 3 decades into the industry. At this point, the question remains is, are these editors, I'm looking at it from a perspective where these editors did try to pull into play a bit more of a critique towards the government. And it's specifically these editors who have been sacked. Do you think there's a political angle towards it?
See, there's always been this. How many of you are familiar with this person called Siddharth Varadarajan? So what was he before he got associated with the school and wire and other things? What was his position? He was a editor of the Hindu. And because he was extremely critical of parties and other things, there was pressure on him and he had to leave. So this kind of pressure, this politicization is something which has increased drastically now. And therefore, sometimes people have put a lot of effort, it's not easy. So these kind of events can be used to that. There will always be, there's always this political angle. And much before this, a lot of very, very capable, I've talked about people like Narendra Takle, nobody's willing to give him a job. He's an excellent journalist, the kind of research he does and the stories he does, he's remarkable. But a lot of people like that, of course, the political pressure, angle, nexus is very big and maybe it's growing. So we'll have to figure out what other solutions there can be in terms of dealing with this. Okay. Any other questions?
Next question is from Rohit. Rohit Patel.
Hello, sir.
Yes, sir.
I wanted to specifically point out the actual role of TRAI, Telecom Regulatory Act of India. Just a few years ago, two or three so. So the Telecom Regulatory Act of India has induced lot more news channels which were not there at all. And they get shut down when there are no elections around in the country. So I wanted to point out that when the a few of the major events that took place, like the people who received awards, like Raymond Magsessy Award, Nobel Prize Award. So these kind of things were not addressed much by such news channels. So there seems to be a pointed north bias towards something from the other content that is happening around the country. So is it again the platforms like Wire, Quint, and the cartoonists, comedians, they are doing well, but they have been continuously filed by sedition cases. So how do we look at such situations to promote the individual journalism? Sorry, I got a little bit.
Yeah. See, the first thing I want to say is when you talk about things like Raymond Magsessy Award, a lot of remarkable people have won, but because many of them are also questioning the establishment. A lot of us don't know the Magsessy Award winners in so many sectors. And much before this tri-regulation and the proliferation of news media, news has been very selective in promoting certain people and not promoting certain people. So that bias is always there. Second is in terms of, yes, that's why I said, when I talked right in the beginning, when you're talking about journalism in India, look at team allows for so many restrictions. And the fact that suddenly in the last 5-6 years, sedition has become such a powerful tool. So therefore, I mean, it's not just sedition, criminal defamation. All these are things which should not be there in an independent country. Even during the Constitutional Assembly, there are many people who felt that sedition law should be dropped. But people felt for some reason they kept it on. So therefore, sedition law is the British era law. Okay. So all of these are basically something which can be misused. And unfortunately, no political party will have the political will to have laws to remove all of them. Unless we have new thinking where people believe that, see, either we don't want to be accountable, or we become so intolerant of criticism, or I don't know what is it that has changed that over a period of time that there is no willingness to engage with contrary opinion. So it's not just with the channels or whatever else. And of course, the channels are obsessed with 3 or 4 topics, and they don't cover a lot of other topics which should be a matter of concern. Okay, even national television, even the coronavirus, which are the states which are doing good work? How do what can we learn from that? We don't really cover that. So therefore, there's a problem in this kind of huge bias where everything seems to be political agenda. It's unfortunate, especially in the broadcast medium. But even in the print, in terms of you're not having stories of success, the only stories which are negative. Also in terms of newspapers should also be, in the beginning I said, media's role is to foster pluralism. We are a plural country. How do you understand, better understanding of other communities, better understanding of other cultures? That's something that doesn't happen, because even now in this whole thing with China, now we don't know how many people from the different states of the Northeast are being targeted. Okay, a lot of them have been evicted from their homes because they are seen as pro-Chinese or Chinese. So there are a lot of things which we don't even get to know. Okay, so that's a, those are real problems. So even when the a lot of them were asked to leave their houses because coronavirus came from China, so therefore these people look different. So there are these huge issues which, again, should have come in the public domain, but it didn't. So as I said, no, because the system is such, unless there is breakthrough by somebody, I don't know what can change. Because currently nobody seems to be wanting to bring about that change. So that's my concern.
Yeah, next question is from Daniel. In times where most news outlets run on certain corporate or politically motivated agendas, what news channels are the most trustworthy and reliable in your opinion?
I don't want to get into this.
Times Now.
Vijay Krishna should be beaten up. I'm not saying, because see, I feel that all news channels have, first of all, I'm not the best person, so I've stopped watching news. So for me to say which is the best channel, I don't think it's fair to even attempt this. But this is something I'm sure all of you can judge for yourself, because this kind of judgment is not the part of this topic. This is for us to understand what are the issues about the press which we need to deal with. Sorry if I haven't answered the question, but this is, I don't want to answer this question. Yeah.
Next one is from Manali. We see lesser and lesser children reading newspapers today. And when they do realize the importance of staying aware, their choice of platform to get it from invariably becomes social media or other rather unreliable digital platforms. In this case, how can we try to instill a keen sense of judgment within them regarding the news they consume? Can schools especially have a role to play in this? I'm reminded of an initiative UNICEF had taken some time ago called the Child Reporters Initiative.
Okay, let me first start with the thing in terms of the children. One of the biggest problems now, I see a lot of it around me, is there's a lot of addiction to screens. So therefore, that's also happening because sometimes either parents don't have the time and energy because the spaces have become limited. So children don't have much to do. So the easiest thing now for them is to get into is an addiction to the screen. That's one. Second, about schools and colleges or homes. The first thing is, unless children are curiosity is, you know, we need to develop a sense of curiosity about the world around them. That is when they will want to know about other things. So some amount of socialization will get them interested in the world around them. Not just in terms of fun and play, but also something which is deeper. Conversations, experiences, walk to museums, history museums, all of that will broaden perspective. Yes, if schools have, but see, schools running newspapers, and this is a good idea, but the school also must have an ethos where it really promotes objective kind of gathering. The school also must not be, must have a high tolerance threshold. The school must also encourage children to ask difficult questions. It rarely happens even in college. So therefore, that's something as individuals, we need to be also, you know, develop this ability to handle contrary opinion. I'll give an example, you know, which is very old, but still relevant. You know, in 2005, there was a, we had a media festival, and one of the activities the TY journalism students did was to have a newspaper. And in the newspaper, they ran a lot of critical stories about the organizers of the festival and how the festival badly ran. And that's a huge fight, and a lot of them very upset that, you know, this is being encouraged in college. So even within a space where young people are doing something, so criticism is was very difficult for them to take, because it was seen as in terms of, oh, you're damaging a reputation, you're spoiling the morale. So all these are always used. So unless we confront this right from in school and college and wherever else, we are not going to have skeptical minds, because we need people more than who consume news, who engage with news. Engaging with news is very important. And what is engaging with news in terms of, you know, having a conversation, asking questions, can this be true? Can we look at other sources? So engaging news will need to be inculcated in all people. And with educational institutions also becoming extremely establishment types, that I don't think is happening much. You need a lot of guts and courage to create that culture. Yeah.
Hi, Kshitij, are you there?
Yes, I'm there.
Yeah. Hello?
Yeah. I thought I got my question.
I'm so sorry. Somehow I managed to miss your request. Yeah, you can ask your question.
I thought my freedom of speech was gagged. But anyway, so my question to sir is, sir, I'm glad you mentioned Noam Chomsky, and Manufacturing Consent is one of his most important books. But in that, he kind of mentions the entire industry, which kind of functions between the government, the media, the private players, and...
Can you be a little louder, please?
Okay. Are you able to hear me, sir?
Yeah.
Okay, so my question is that I'm glad you mentioned Noam Chomsky and Manufacturing Consent, one of his most important books, in which he kind of mentions the kind of relationship between the government, the business houses, the civil society and people. And he says that this is a nexus which is extremely difficult to kind of break. It's almost impossible to break, and therefore the dominance of this kind of correlation will level. It's like a well-oiled machinery. So in the rising kind of discussion about the optimism of independent media, so Chomsky kind of 4 decades ago mentions that there is no such concept as independent media. At some point of time, everything is connected to each other. So like, how do you look at this entire scenario? Because almost 4 decades later, Chomsky is still extremely relevant.
No, see, Chomsky's background also is very critical of a lot of things which can happen in a capitalist and open society. So there is a little bit of bias. What he said is true, the nexus between industry, advertising revenue, all of that. But that has not stopped a lot of journalists from having... from questioning in spaces which have been fairly independent. But the utilizing revenue to pressurize a newspaper to fall into line has been used in different places, including now in Kashmir. So therefore, that is true. But is there possibility for independent voices? Yes, if you look at magazines like Economic and Political Weekly, it is maybe niche. But they've created a space which is not dependent on popular advertising and whatever else for them to be able to. Many years ago, of course, that initiative was shut down. There was a magazine for women called Manushi. Now, Manushi as a magazine at one time was something which was completely based on subscription. So I'm saying that there will be spaces where, or as I said, I gave the example of Kabul area, or there may be many other examples which I'm sure, or there's something which has not been imagined till now. So whether it is, when you say independent, I'm just saying it's something which questions the establishment where things go wrong. Truly independent, whether it is possible, necessary, I don't know. Because when you talk about things like development journalism, you talk about public journalism, you're also taking positions, you know, in that sense. So therefore, those are issues which we'll have to resolve. But I think there is a possibility for voices which can... which allow for contrary opinions to be expressed. Because my thing is that in any kind of space, there must be a lot of contrary opinion. Okay. Because that allows people to change, people to reform. Because if you're not challenged, you'll possibly continue. There will be no progress if contrary opinions are not there. There won't be accountability, there won't be transparency. So maybe now these voices are still very niche. Maybe it can become more mainstream, we don't know. Yeah.
Thank you very much, sir.
Yeah. Next one is from Zubin. Don't you think in order to achieve pluralism, a more moderate approach towards opinions is required where both sides can be heard and respected?
No, definitely. That's why I said, no. See, for me, the most important thing is not debate, because television is debate. I always say, in terms of, can we have a dialogue? Can we have conversations? Can we listen to each other? That's something that I've been constantly saying. Okay, this is something which we're not listening to each other. Because I also found that even when you look at something like the Narmada Bachao Andolan, at some point of time, I felt they become very intransigent. Okay? Are they open to discussion? I don't know, because sometimes we think only our position is right, and we are not really listening. Second, as I said, we're also not talking in a way the other person can listen. We are attacking, we are criticizing. So are we also offering solutions? Are we also offering alternatives? And how do you get people to look at alternatives? So some kind of, you know, this inclusion of both sides, what we call synthesis, that needs to be practiced. So Zubin, you're very right. It's not just moderation, but listening, inclusion. But moderation is definitely very important. Because our voices are less shrill, maybe others will listen. And if you also listen to them, maybe we can speak in a language which they understand what we are saying. Because we are not listening to each other because we think they are attacking us. So all of that, yes, there is what you say is important, and I hope you figure out how to do that.
Yeah. Next question is from Noel. How can one be on rock solid grounds personally so that they cannot not allow any political or third party intervention to maintain free journalism?
See, one is, see, you need to have a viable economic model. Okay? What's a viable economic model? You must be able to generate revenue, either through subscription or some way in which you can pay for your costs. Okay, so that is, you'll have to figure out that. So are you going to do through crowdfunding? Are you going to create through a foundation? So all of that is something which you will need to explore, because there are foundations globally which are willing to support independent journalism. Search for those foundations. Okay. Offhand, I can't remember, because I know foundations which are there. I can try and remember or maybe put it on the plate. But we'll have to try and see whether that can be also can help us with initial seed money. So different business models, different economic models will have to be explored. Because finally, any enterprise has to be viable. It must be able to sustain itself. It must be able to pay people working for it a decent package. Because it's not viable. You won't really attract the best people if you're not able to pay decent salaries. So therefore, that is very important. So how we can manage, how long we can sustain. First, I mean, in terms of course, if you look at a magazine like Caravan, at least till now, they're able to have good quality narrative journalism. How long they can sustain, we don't know. They will always be, that's why I said, maybe if you search, you'll find a lot of such examples of voices which are independent. And then figure out, create your own networks for that.
Yeah. Next one is from Sabiha. Is print media better than electronic media, TV channels, if we want to consume news? As the latter exhibits more sensationalism, passes off opinion as news, involves volatile debates, which play a part in perception building.
See, in terms of whether what is better or worse is difficult, because they for a lot of people, television journalism, television has a lot more potential because audiovisual, and there also you can have informed conversations. The climate for that has maybe changed in the last few years, therefore that's not very conducive. Print, of course, can allow for a lot more reflection, because you can read it at your pace, you can think. So there's a lot. So both have their advantages and disadvantages. Currently, maybe print journalism in India at least seem to have greater depth and breadth than broadcast journalism. This is my understanding. Maybe I'm wrong, but this is my understanding. Yeah. But which is better in terms of real objectivity, I don't know. Yeah.
Yeah, next one is from Antara. Do you think journalism is influenced by power?
Of course it will be. In terms of, there can be people who are who can take a stand against the establishment. There have been people in the past. So if you look at the example of newspapers like Statesman, Indian Express in the Emergency, and Punjab Kesari, they stood up against the establishment. So there will be some who will challenge the system, and they will be able to survive, okay, because of their values and whatever other things which are important to sustain them. But a lot of people will possibly succumb. It also will depend on the kind of political culture which allows for a lot of authoritarian tends to grow. Then maybe this independent space will shrink. How much will it shrink will need to be seen. Okay, but there will always be this correlation. Power will always try and ensure that it's not made too accountable or it's not in terms of challenge too much. So that confrontation between an independent and the institution, the power will always be there.
Yeah. Before we move on to the next question, Abhishek Vidate has put up a link for the feedback form for today and also a link to join the WhatsApp group. Next question is from Vijay. He wants to ask you a question.
Hi, sir. You spoke about taking sides, but the thing is, as a journalist, what is the fine line? I mean, when you say speaking truth to power or speaking truth to government, what is the thin line for a journalist? Because right now, when you criticize the BJP, you're already taking a side. If you're saying if you're criticizing somebody, you're already seen as taking a side. As a journalist, what is the fine line? Do you think, because the public opinion has changed so much, because if I'm taking if I'm criticizing BJP, I'm pro Congress. If I'm pro Congress, I don't know. So it's always that dilemma that's fed into already the crowd, that agar ye koi BJP ke baare mein bol raha hai, so that means he's obviously anti BJP and he's not. So how do you draw that thin line, and how do I convince my editor?
Okay, see, there are two things. One is it's finally not about a party. As a journalist, you must look at, you know, what the rules are, you know, what the system allows for. Any deviation by anyone should be questioned and challenged. Okay. So therefore, if your homework is good, you will be able to possibly open up contradictions and show all of that. Second, it's true that in the current situation, how do you convince the editor? It's very difficult if the, forget the editor, if the management itself decides that it doesn't want to choose confrontation, then your choice becomes limited. And when you talk about perception, yes. See, when you say perception, in a politicized kind of atmosphere, that will be by some of them. But I'm sure a lot of other people will try and listen to you, because you're saying something which is based on a lot of facts. So if your facts are strong, if you can explain them properly, maybe there'll still be people who are open to what you're saying. So in journalism, if you can avoid any kind of personal attack, any kind of personal things, and say that this is what the thing is, this is what we're concerned about, this is not being addressed, okay, and raise questions. Okay? And raise questions in a way which is not very confrontational. Maybe some conversation may happen. But that is something which each journalist will have to figure out on the field, because sitting in a room like this, you know, I really don't know what the challenges are. But your... The fine line is your what are the facts, what are the things you're probing, and in terms of, it is just correlating that. True, you will be perceived as this or that, which can't be helped in this. Hopefully things will change. But I don't really have any clear answers beyond saying that if your homework is correct, if your facts are in place, you're not getting personal, then you may be able to have content which more people may see it as balanced.
Just to add on to what you said, I think so, from personal experience, even if the editor likes my story, and even if it's presented with a lot of facts, the management comes in over there. Like one of my immediate bosses, my managers, he once told the MBAs have come and destroyed journalism. I mean, it may sound funny, but that comes with a lot of truth, because at the end of the day, there's a business angle towards it, and I've been suppressed by my editor might believe in my story. It's like, theek hai, chala do ye story. If you have facts, if you have everything, all your elements ready, we'll break this news, we'll go ahead with this news. But at the end of the day, I might run this news. Within an hour, maybe he gets a call and he says, you know what, doesn't make sense.
No, no. See, I do not see. The thing is, whether NBA is destroyed or not, I said, the first newspaper we decided to treat as a business was Times of India. And that was the owner, Samir Jain, who wanted to make it economically profitable or whatever else. But in a lot of times, I don't think it's just the business thing. Sometimes it's the political pressure. A lot of things which come into play. And true. Unless your group is sound in many ways and cannot, will not easily succumb, it's very difficult to do stories which are, in that sense, in the front line of, exposing problems and scandals and whatever else.
Yeah. Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Next question is from Ajay Kumar.
Yeah.
I strongly believe that full representation can help to bridge the gap between disabled and non-disabled.
Can you repeat the question, please? Yeah.
I strongly believe that full representation can help to bridge the gap between disabled and non-disabled people. Almost all of our Hindi films end up portraying disability as caricaturing, over heroism, sixth sense, pity, not being independent, and most shockingly as not having sexual feelings, which is so untrue. In my research, I found that most of non-disabled people also look at disability in the same grounds. What are your views on such false representations which has resulted in the gap in the society?
See, the issue with disability is right from the time of Plato and across, a lot of people are uncomfortable with what they think is not so perfect. And therefore, people with disabilities have never been fully respected, not just in journalism, but in whether it's in literature, narratives, in socialization. So language is very disrespectful for people to people with disabilities. That's one. Second, if you look at journalism, whether it's print or this, has never really taken up the issue of people with disabilities, okay, in terms of their concerns, in terms of giving them real space for that is necessary for this to become a part of political agenda. Films, as you say, is not just in terms, as I said, so many categories, so many groups of people. People who write scripts have no understanding. So therefore, they definitely caricature, which is extremely unfortunate. So therefore, for us to develop empathy, it's impossible, because we're socialized by films and everybody else to see them as people who are what somebody calls children of a lesser god. Okay, that's a statement. So therefore, that's the unfortunate reality. And this is very true. I mean, I think this is an old English film, Children of a Lesser God, on people with disabilities. Maybe you should watch the film and maybe we could learn something from that portrayal. Also, in terms of various kinds of disabilities, whether mental or physical, a lot of us don't, filmmakers don't do sufficient research to understand it. No, that's the problem itself. Yeah.
Next is more of a comment from Sujit. Recently, I had attended a webinar by the Baha'i community where they were dwelling upon the possibility of how media could facilitate interfaith dialogue. And this was in the light of the recent covering of the Jamaat-e-Islam. I hope that the communal polemics of the media houses would change to incorporate more dialogue, which could foster plurality.
It's very, the interfaith space, interfaith conversation dialogue, is extremely important, and I think over a period of time that is reduced. Though in terms of print media there is still some attempt to do that, in broadcast media that is possibly, there is no space for that itself. But understanding in terms of different things, there is definitely a need for more tone down conversations in terms of, you know, acceptance, and so that's important. That's very important, which is not happening at all. Yeah.
Next one is from Pinby Thomas. Why is it that actual news gets sidelined and mainstream gossip becomes new headlines? What has changed in the past few years?
See, over a period of time, that newspaper like Times of India, and maybe that's what even newspaper like Telegraph says, if you have to sell the newspaper, lifestyle stories make more sell better. So it's unfortunate that in terms of things which should be in page 5, 6 or another supplement, end up in the front page. So this is basically, as I said, started with Sameer Jain, who said that it's a commodity, package it well. So packaging it well meant giving a lot more importance to lifestyle stories. So therefore, that's the unfortunate thing. So a lot of real news doesn't really get covered or focused on.
Yeah. Rohan, are you there?
Yes.
I'm sorry, I missed your question.
No problem.
Yeah.
Hi, sir.
Yeah.
Hi, Rohan.
So my question is something you mentioned earlier about the influence PR has on coverage, especially in print. And this is an observation of mine where I've noticed that a lot of journalists, experienced journalists, freely move into PR to elevated positions, right? So do you think that PR's influence on journalism will always be affected due to this factor, and this is something that needs to have a relook, perhaps?
Yeah, because see, in terms of a lot of experienced journalists are also quoted by PR companies because they have good contacts. They can also get their stories printed. So that's the problem, because a lot of journalism now in many spaces is getting replaced by PR, which is very unfortunate. So therefore, that distance between journalists and PR will have to be got back, which has to be, which is very necessary, because often in terms of this is where the real journalism suffers. Okay, so that's a problem.
Yeah. Thank you, sir.
Are you able to hear me clearly?
Yeah.
Or should I be louder?
No, now it's okay.
Okay. Next question is from Tejas Kalyankar.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
So I had this question. Since a few recent years, we've seen journalism and, well, news stories coming out of really like places we didn't expect. So it might be in the West, it might be the late night shows like John Oliver, Trevor Noah, Stephen Colbert. In India, from YouTube channels like Dhruv Rathi, Akash Banerjee. And it's on both the left and right side. So these outlets do not have the responsibility or the consequences of being a journalist. And people are still, people have lost faith in the real media, real news media. So people are taking their information, taking their news content from these people. But this source lacks the responsibility that a journalist has, as well as the consequences that a real journalist might face instead of something goes wrong. So what is your view on that?
See, as I said, over a period of time in India, last 20 years itself, journalism itself has become less accountable.
Yeah.
Okay. I gave, right in the beginning of my session, I talked about this columnist who did something which was very wrong, but the newspaper, nobody really corrected, and there were no consequences. So when you say that journalists face consequences, a lot of powerful news channels and agencies don't face consequences for misinformation, for not doing enough research. So that has become a trend. So it's not just these independent sources where people are commenting or who are creating spaces which are not responsible, but overall, this whole journalism space has become less accountable, less responsible. So if you are responsible to people understanding what the truth is, then a lot of it would have got corrected. So at the moment, that's why in the beginning I said agencies like Press Council of India.
Right.
Even in regular journalism, they're not able to correct so much of wrong which is happening. And
the regulation is the regulation is weak.
Yeah, they're not able to do that. But so, and this newly emerging space of social media, there's absolutely no regulation.
Yeah.
And as I said,
go on.
Let me finish. So in the there's no regulation. Also, we also don't see there is no basic. What should I say? Normally, we use the word hygiene. So basic rules which you should follow for any kind of communication. So this whole trolling and hate speech is something which also damaged a lot of conversations which can happen. So therefore, we need to figure out, of course, courts and governments say you should self-regulate, but unless there is some kind of framework, some kind of accepted principles, things are not going to change. But not being accountable and not being responsible is not necessarily these new spaces which are emerging, but even traditional spaces are not responsible and accountable.
These things are even presented as satire and comedy instead of news sources, instead of actually reporting.
No, but many of them, see, many of them don't even say they're news. They are basically saying that it's a comment. So right. When you say news, they themselves are not saying that we are people who are journalists, but we are people who are engaging with the political process or social process. We are commentators. So therefore, that, of course, maybe make them less responsible. But I feel even traditional regular journalists themselves are not doing sufficient homework and are not responsible enough. That's the biggest problem of media today.
Thank you, sir.
So there are four questions to go. So are we addressing them today itself?
We can if people are waiting, yeah.
Okay. One is from Mehmood. Corporates, as part of their business strategies, have started to invest in their own channel to gain a voice and beat competition. Should a journalist have any qualms for joining such a channel and do it as a job? Your views on it.
See, the first thing is in terms of A, they may be, see, even earlier, a lot of corporates have run, have had interest in journalism. If there's space for you to be able to do what you want, it should not be a problem. That's one. Second is in terms of if you're somebody who has a clear idea of what kind of journalist you want to be, then you will choose where you want to join. Okay. So if reporting is just a kind of a job for you without really much attention paid to the journalistic values and ethics, then it doesn't matter which you take up your job or not. So that will be an individual decision. What is the kind of journalism you want to do? And therefore, which organization suits your needs? That's that you'll have to figure out.
Yeah. We have a second question from Meghna. Do you think journalism on social media can be very padded with privilege? What is your take on armchair activism?
Well, that's why I said this social media is completely unregulated terrain. And therefore, anybody who has access to, who can say things is saying. So therefore, that there will be need for, as I said, if you don't have ground rules, it's complete law of the jungle and all kinds of things are happening. So therefore, that's one problem. Yes, it is, as the earlier question by Tejas said, that one is not even responsible for what one is saying. That's also the problem with even, a lot of us get our information from Wikipedia. Wikipedia also, there is not enough, often cross-checking of facts. So a lot of things which are not authentic also, entries can be made. There may be some little bit of a checking now, but a lot of it just, people get away with it. So therefore, that's the problem. See, this, everybody thinks that their opinion is the right opinion without being open to discussing, to check whether their opinion is based on facts or right understanding. Yeah.
Question from Manali. Is there any way in which we can make our Prime Minister hold more press conferences and talk to journalists who have questions other than his fakiri and his jhola to ask him? Is there any way we can hold our political leaders accountable to engage more democratically with the media without rehearsals? Is it a part of our rights and duties as citizens? Because the only time we get to hear them is during political rallies and sometimes those shouting matches called debates.
So what we can get the Prime Minister to do or not is something which I can't answer. Because that he has to decide and his advisors have to decide. So therefore, that is something which we have. And also maybe over a period of time, the culture of journalism in India has become so sycophantic. We've allowed this kind of non-accountability to proliferate for a variety of people, not just the Prime Minister, but a lot of people in power, in corporate, etc., get away saying things, and they're not really accountable. So therefore, one way, as I said, is that in terms of, unless there is more of a voice which is demanding, which I said, unless there is a critical mass, nothing will change. Unless you have sufficient numbers of people who are saying that this is something which you want to change. Because, you know, many years ago, there was this conservator of forests who said that because trees don't have votes, nobody takes the environment seriously. So unless people who believe that the system should be more accountable can influence a lot more people who will vote in a certain direction, or who can actually influence political change in direction, things will not change. So therefore, unless a lot more people on both sides of the ideological spectrum can develop skeptical thinking, are willing to question things, I mean, it looks a little bleak. So it's easy for people like me to push the responsibility on to younger people so that you guys can do something about it. So figure out, let's use our imagination, see what comes out.
Yeah, the last one from today is Tinby by Tinby Thomas. Is the media accountable to publish facts? Many a times fake news leads to a lot of problems. So are journalists accountable, or is it that news channels, newspapers can get away with anything?
See, as I said in the beginning, because we don't have a very strong regulatory authority, there's nobody who can hold a newspaper responsible if they report facts wrongly. See, even in terms of often when they correct facts, they don't do it on the first page, they don't publish apology on the first page, and there's nobody who can make them do it. Not just the powerful newspapers, even smaller newspapers have gotten away because there is no regulatory mechanism to check this. And also, a lot of readers also are not too concerned. If a lot of readers got angry and said that, no, we will boycott the paper if you don't report facts correctly, newspaper will be forced to do that. Because, you know, if you look at if a newspaper is a product, then consumers have a lot of power. If you can get together and demand and say that we will not accept this. Okay? So therefore, that is the important thing, that if you see it as a service which newspapers are providing, and we are paying for it, in whatever extent, with our time and whatever else, so therefore we must begin to demand better quality content. So if today, in terms of all these noisy channels, if 10,000 people write to them and said, we'll boycott if you don't have more reasonable debates, they're also worried about TRP. So we have the power, you know, of our engagement with them. So figure out how we can influence more people to make news channels accountable. It may take time, but we can start by figuring out how that can be done.
Yeah, yeah, this was the last question, sir.
Okay.
So we come to an end for the session for today. Thank you.
Tomorrow,